Please welcome everybody. Please find a seat if you don't have one yet. Good afternoon. Welcome at Naturalis Biodiversity Center. I'm very happy that you're all here for the meeting on the NWO program on Caribbean research in the Caribbean Netherlands. Naturalis is the Netherlands Biodiversity Institute, and I must admit that the last couple of years that the Netherlands has gotten a different meaning partly, because a few years ago we've been here as well, and that was the first call of the Caribbean program. And in the meantime, at Naturalis at least, we've dug up our collections of the Caribbean islands. We had a course, an expedition in Stacia. I was there in October, and I must admit, it was fantastic. I felt really proud to be Dutch when I saw the first hummingbirds in the Netherlands, the first palm trees, the first banana trees, and those kind of things. I'm a tropical biologist, so I really loved seeing that. And I also saw that that these islands are quite far from the mainland in many, many ways. Far from the mainland in the sense that there's a lot of unknown things there. We discovered many species that for the first time had been found on Stacia. The people there have cultures and ways of living which I love, but they are very much removed from here. It also felt as if the Netherlands treated them a bit at the end of the empire, to be honest. And that's why I'm very happy that the NWO now has a second part of the call, of the second call for proposals, and that also the interaction with the people, with the needs at the islands and those aspects have become more prominent. So I hope you'll have a very nice meeting here. And now I hand over to Dolphy de Brot, who is your chairman of the day.
Thank you very much, Koos. Thank you all for your presence today, and special hello to everyone watching via the live stream as well. One of the greatest challenges to mankind in the coming decades is the goal of achieving ecological sustainability on planet Earth. This illustrates the kind of problems you encounter in the Dutch Caribbean when dealing with sustainability. On this side, you see goats along a cliffside in Lower Town on Sint Eustatius. These animals are responsible for breaking loose large boulders that actually damage buildings at the bottom of the cliff, but they also endanger the integrity of historical resources and buildings at the top of the cliff. It's an ecological problem, but there is also a social aspect and an economic aspect that actually keeps this situation going. So it's not only an ecological problem, but it has other aspects. And here on the other side, we see a massive development along the coast in St. Maarten on the Dutch side. What you see there is destruction of coastal woodlands. You see interruption of the ecological connectivity between land and sea. Interference on the nesting beaches of endangered sea turtles. And also a big smear of sediment going into your seagrass beds. So major challenges. In dealing with sustainability issues, what is critical is new knowledge, but also critical is the ability to distinguish between what is nice to know and what is a need to know. There's a great deal of urgency for such knowledge, knowledge that can really make a difference, and our life actually depends on it. But once you have the right knowledge, the next issue is to know how to get from knowledge to impact, because that's one of the themes or criteria for this call. It typically takes a period before you get from knowledge to the result that you want. A lot of knowledge is self-serving. in the scientific sense. But for this call, a particular focus will be knowledge for impact. Typically, it takes a long time, decades, before the knowledge actually trickles down into impact. And it's also often what you see is only a portion of the knowledge that actually results in effect. And the trick for us is to make sure that the knowledge that we produce actually feeds into the stream for impact, and also that a large portion actually ends up in result. Well, in the first Caribbean call that came out in 2013, the goal was framed as a broad multidisciplinary program with topics of scientific excellence and societal relevance to the Dutch Caribbean. Our analyses actually show that it also successfully met these goals. But after assessment and broad consultation with various stakeholders, it was still decided to add a new twist to this formula for the second call. And the twist is what I've been talking about, science for local impact. And you may ask, why this choice? Well, while sustainability is difficult everywhere, it is especially difficult in tropical island settings. The small scale of the ecosystem and other factors translate into many limitations that need to be dealt with. Limitations in terms of space, genetic diversity, institutional capacity, funding. What you have in tropical islands is that because of the small spatial scale, everything that happens or that doesn't happen actually impacts everything else. So there is a much less scope for mistakes. And also it impacts your resilience of your system. Now, our job as the program committee was to design the scientific context to meet these overarching purposes of the call. In a few minutes, I'll ask Pieter van Breukering, who was a member of the committee, to step up and tell you more about the scientific context, which was our main assignment. We had a team of 9 scientists from diverse scientific specialties in our committee. Let me see if you find the right button here. Ooh. Yes, this is the one I needed. Yeah, so this was our team. Bert Hoeksema from Naturalis, myself, Imaris, Corien Hofman from Leiden, Gert Oost-Indië from the KITLV, and Hebe Verrest, Erik de Ruiter van Stevenink, Pieter van Breukenink, who you will hear speak in a few minutes, Ludo Verhoeven, and Jessica Kiefte de Jong. Basically, the ingredients to bring a diverse and well-balanced scientific context for this call. As you may have seen already, we have a very full program for you this afternoon. After the introduction, so Pieter is the second speaker here, or the third one, with the scientific context. We have 6 presentations to bring you the preliminary results of the work that was started under the first call. The purpose of that is to inspire you. After our break, we have Niels van den Berg to give the technical details. So you'll hear about the scientific context and the technical details. Really nice is that he can answer questions you may have. Most of the information, or actually all of the information, is available online already. Am I right, Niels? Yes. And a bunch of other presentations to inspire you. And we also have poster session going on in the back here. I'd like to point you to that as well. And let's see. Yeah, I think that that more or less covers it. And so without too much further ado, I would like to pass the mic to Pieter, who will give you details, fill you in on the scientific context for this call. Pieter?
Okay, what I will do is elaborate a little further on the scientific context of this call. F5, there we go. I'm representing the program committee that Dolphy just explained about and try to summarize the inputs of these various members. Before going into the scientific context of the call, I would like to reiterate what the call also describes in terms of the multidisciplinary approach that it aims for, which consists of four elements. Scientific excellence is important because we want to create good and innovative knowledge. At the same time, the call aims to encourage collaboration and partnerships. Collaboration within the islands, but also between the mainland, the Netherlands, and the islands. At the same time, we really aim for fostering sustainable development. And that's what Dolphy just explained. We really want to achieve an impact with this call, which is felt on the islands. And an important element of that is that we need to build regional capacity as well. So proposals are encouraged to have capacity building elements in their proposals. When we joined in our meeting to discuss the scientific context of the call, we pretty soon arrived at one common denominator, which was maybe not as explicitly present in the first call. In the first call, we felt that all these projects were extremely relevant, extremely excellent, but we were missing a common denominator. How do we position all these projects and studies and programs? And we felt that a common denominator of the second call could be the context of small island development states. How can we assist small island development states in creating a more sustainable society, environment, or economy? Small island development states are characterized by their small size, a relatively small number of people. At the same time, they face high population densities, are limited in availability of natural resources in terms of water, energy, mineral resources. And they all face challenges which are often quite comparable in terms of environmental, economic, sociocultural, and public health challenges. Let me address some of these issues. So typical challenges that small island developments face are their high dependence on imports. So most of the resources need to be imported to maintain their society. Often these economies are rather dependent on a single sector, which is often the tourist industry. Cost of maintaining society in terms of public facilities, education, health, infrastructure are relatively high because of the lack of economies of scale. So these are challenges, economic challenges, that small island development states face. From a socio-political angle, also quite comparable challenges can be identified. So the inequalities, both socially and economically, are quite prominent. Limited diversity of educational facilities, again, very much caused by the lack of economies of scale. Migration, unemployment, leading to brain drain, especially among young people, and complex political and cultural dynamics. At the same time, environmental challenges are also quite comparable. Islands have generally very high levels of biodiversity, yet at the same time, the populations of these biological species are small, scattered and fragmented. We've seen projects that address invasive species. So invasive species are quite typical on these islands and form a major threat. And most of these islands are characterized by strong linkages between terrestrial ecosystems and marine ecosystems. So what we need is, do we need projects that focus on one specific ecological aspect, and will that help? Will that be the smartest investment in making these islands more sustainable? It may be, but at the same time, we feel that an integrated approach is needed to address the complexity and the interlinkages between economic, social, political, and environmental systems. And that's why we sort of brushed off a rather old concept, the people, planet, profit concept, which is very broad, but which also shows that, well, typical challenges in island societies where sustainability can only be reached if you take into account the people's aspect, the profit aspect, and the planet aspect. And I think this is the framework. This is the framework in which we like to position this call. And I think we encourage proposals that address at least two of those elements, rather than having strictly monodisciplinary proposals. Although they may be excellent for scientific reasons, for the purpose of creating a more sustainable islands, we think we need to cover those overlapping areas. Let me address some of the challenges within these three domains, which are potentially subject for this proposal. I emphasize that this is not an all-encompassing list. I remember 2 years ago, the same questions came from the room and said, should we limit to what is presented on this? And that's definitely not the case. So whatever way you would like to interpret this, this is just a source of inspiration, which we feel are important challenges, for instance, in the people domain, in which we want to create good governance for health, heritage, education, identity. So what are these typical issues? Well, an important issue is local governance, and see to what extent quality and the functioning of local governance can be improved. Public health has major challenges in terms of obesity or diabetes. Educational systems, which are faced with formal and informal systems that require improvement and still need to deal with the, as I said, small scale that these islands are faced with. Issues of social cohesion, identities, gender issues, and at the same time cultural heritage management, which also from an archaeological point of view requires attention. From the planet perspective, the environment, what we would like to see is to create or improve the resilience of the environment and ecosystems. Issues you can think of is obviously vulnerability to climate change. Typical subjects are pressures caused by tourism or other economic sectors, but obviously tourism is an important one. The islands are faced with habitat degradation. I mean, the goat problem is a well-known one, causing erosion, causing nutrient loss, and having all kinds of effects on coral reefs, which are such an important ecological resource for the economic sectors on the islands. Settlement of non-native species, invasive species, which I mentioned earlier, and water quantity and quality issues. In the profit domain, and please mind, allow me to explain that profit is not necessarily profit in the financial sense, it's really profit from a societal point of view, economic welfare and well-being. The aim would be to develop a mature and green economy, recognizing the fact that a lot of these economic sectors depend on the natural resources. Issues that could be addressed is sort of how do we build up a natural capital that is sustainable for future generations, how to design land use planning, conservation zoning in such a way that it allows for economic development as well as nature conservation, how to promote entrepreneurship on these islands, to make sure that we have sort of self-sufficient economies and an active private sector that operates in a sustainable manner. Community-based management practices to see whether we can promote grassroots initiatives, design adaptation strategies for climate change, and we would like to stress across all these themes that these issues can only be addressed if we look at them from multiple scales, from local scales, a regional scale, but also an international scale in terms of the relationships that the islands have with the Netherlands. And then finally, I would like to draw your attention to a list which is also printed in the call text. This is the result of an inventory made by NWO in terms of the critical issues that were identified by a number of influential stakeholders on the islands, which is kind of a wish list, perhaps, of local stakeholders that could be addressed, which are, of course, we took those into account as well in designing the call text. So again, if we allocate them across these three themes, issues like unemployment, migration, circular economies were mentioned, many more, but you can find those in the text. In terms of, well, the more social domain, we see multilingualism, which is a difficult word, sorry. Especially in education is a major issue, of course. Heritage and issues like, well, health issues like diabetes. And then in terms of sustainability, how could these islands set up a well-functioning system of waste, water, and energy management? And how can we support with our research nature protection in a sustainable way? So this more or less brings me to the end. I think the floor is now open for questions or remarks. Is it crystal clear? Yes, please.
Hello, my name is Flora Goudappel. I'm the Dean of the Law School of the University of Curaçao. And I was wondering how much for each of the topics you really want interdisciplinary research. So is it, do you want as a total interdisciplinary research, or do you want each application to be interdisciplinary?
I think for the program, I think for the first call, you would also be able to say, well, it's not interdisciplinary because these projects do not necessarily collaborate, as far as I know. So it's the first call is broad and covers multiple disciplines. I think with this call text, with the second call, we would like to encourage people to be in the overlapping areas. In other words, projects by themselves be multi or interdisciplinary, maybe even transdisciplinary. Okay, good.
Thank you, Peter. I would like to ask Jessica Reutmann and Wouter Veenendaal to come forward. Okay, Wouter. And they will present to us their topic of confronting Caribbean challenges in terms of putting plans into practice.
So we're actually not going to talk about our research project, our Confronting Caribbean Challenges, specifically. We figure if you're interested, you're welcome to come and talk to us in the breaks. We also have a website, the Kaitelve website, which has more information about our project as a whole. One of the PhDs with our project, Stacey McDonald, is presenting a poster, so you can also talk to her. Instead, what we thought we would do this afternoon is talk about both the challenges we faced doing this research, this interdisciplinary research, as Willow explained, also the opportunities or benefits from doing this kind of research. We're doing this with an eye towards opening up conversations with those of you who are here in the room who've got funded with the last call, but also to those many of you in the hall today who are thinking of applying for such a grant, to give you information on these challenges and these opportunities.
Yes, and we will start with the challenges, actually. And one of the first challenges we encountered is that we encountered some questions and opposition from local academics on the islands, because in the first place we were perceived as a competition sometimes. And secondly, there was a sense of, okay, you've received a big grant from the Netherlands, you're coming here on these islands to do research, but you're not really asking us to participate. There are no finances for us to do research as well. And you're basically taking the knowledge and the research that you do back to Holland and study it over there. So there was this really this sense of kind of post-colonial academic situation. And that, so it reflects or it speaks to broader concerns about academic structures and perspectives on the islands. Secondly, having presented, so it's the next one, yeah. Having presented some findings and having conducted some research on the islands, we also encountered, and this is a rather extreme example, a backlash sometimes from local bloggers or academics or activists on the islands who also reflected or actually emphasized this post-colonial system and this white type of research being conducted on the islands. So it's one of the things that we've encountered. This is an extreme example, and most of the people, as we will talk about later, have been very friendly towards us, but this is definitely a sentiment that we have been having to dealing with.
So, challenges of interdisciplinarity, and I should talk up well. I said I wasn't going to talk too much about our project, but I should say I'm a postdoc on the project, as is Wouter. I'm an historian. Wouter's a political scientist. Stacy McDonald, who I mentioned earlier, is a social psychologist. And Sana Rotmeier, who's actually doing research right now on the islands, is doing media studies. So one of the challenges to this interdisciplinarity has been publishing. There's a lot of talk in academia about how wonderful interdisciplinarity is. A lot of talk in the MBO encouraging it. But the reality that we found thus far in our project is that certainly journals, for instance, lag far behind. Happily, Wouter and I have just heard the happy news that an article we wrote together from a historical and a political science perspective has been accepted for publication. But finding a journal that really wanted to incorporate that interdisciplinary approach has been a challenge, particularly top journals. We'll talk about all the benefits of interdisciplinarity in a minute, but one thing, we all sit in a room together, our interdisciplinary team, and really relating to each other, sometimes feeling like we're actually speaking the same language, helping each other with our research can be a challenge because we're coming at it from such different perspectives. So yeah, and this leads into the next big challenge. Let's face it, and with all due respect, the Bess Islands, and that's Islanda, so that was the focus of the last call, are pretty small. Well, they're not pretty small, they're just really small. They're peripheral in a lot of discussions and debates, even within the Caribbean context. So what we've been trying to do is link, and we'll talk more about this in a minute, is link our research on these small islands to broader debates within our respective fields via, as I mentioned, journals, but also conferences. That remains a challenge. And this is especially for Wouter and me, but for the two PhDs as well in the future, related to the pretty dismal academic job market in the Netherlands, worldwide, but also in the Netherlands. Basically, when this project's over, we need to find jobs, preferably permanent jobs, right? And finding ways to leverage our very specific knowledge on these very small and in a lot of larger debates, seemingly at least peripheral islands, is a challenge for us.
So moving on, before it gets all a little bit too gloomy, to the positive side. So I just mentioned that we encountered some opposition on the islands when we started doing our research there, but fortunately that has really been a minority. So most of the people that we've been working on with on the islands have been really supportive, really welcoming, and have also been very interested in our research and very willing to participate. So, for example, this is a picture of Jessica with the uncrowned king, an island historian of Ceiba, Will Johnson, who she's been talking with and discussing the history of the island and of St. Martin and Stacia. And just a couple of days before that, I also met him to talk about politics and his experiences in democracy on Ceiba. And the second picture is me with one of the interviewers we used for our opinion survey on Curaçao. So we've also really made an effort to reach out to local academics, activists on the island. And most of them have really been very eager and willing to participate and have also been very eager in sharing their expertise and knowledge about the islands with us. So we're also really grateful for that. Secondly, I mentioned that we've received a little bit of negative attention sometimes on Twitter and on Facebook about our research findings. But what is really a positive aspect of doing research on these islands is the amount of coverage in the media of the islands, so local media. And as you can see, we've received quite some positive attention for our projects, for each of our projects. So there's been attention for Jessica's sociocultural history of the Windward Islands. There's been attention for the survey. We've been able to publish opinion pieces in media outlets on Curaçao, Aruba, and St. Martin. And also, we've managed to also reach the Dutch media sources with our project. So that's really a positive element, I find, of doing research on these islands. It's really easy to get attention for your research.
So I talked just a minute ago about some of the challenges of doing interdisciplinary research, but it can also be immensely rewarding. As I said, sometimes we don't feel like we're always speaking each other's languages, and that's not just because I'm from America. That's because of our disciplinary backgrounds. On the other hand, that has huge advantages. That's been really rewarding. I think we've all learned a lot, and I think what we've learned from each other's disciplines has impacted our own research and within our own sub-projects in a really, really positive way. So that's been really good. An example of that would be identity, or the concept of identity, which is one of the overarching themes with which our whole Confronting Caribbean Challenges project deals with. But each of us has a different concept or view of what identity really is from our disciplinary perspectives. And we've been able to incorporate those different views of identity and how it works and what it means into our sub-projects. On a very practical level as well, as many of you all know, doing field work, being off, people envy us, of course, and say, well, you shouldn't complain, you're off in the Caribbean doing research. But it can be really lonely. We're away from our families, we're away from our friends. As I mentioned, our PhD, Sana, has been there for quite a while. We've been able to plan a lot of our trips to at least overlap with each other. We can help each other practically, logistically, and also, yeah, just be together. So that takes some of the edge of that loneliness of doing research off. To conclude, looking back, our project has been going for a year and a half, or Wouter and I have been on it for a year and a half, Stacy and Sana, the PhDs, for a little over a year. I think we've accomplished a great deal, if we do say so ourselves, and that's not just in terms of output or deliverables, to use grant funding language, although that's been really nice too. But really in terms of the insights we're gaining. What's also, I think, almost or as important, more important really, is, as Wouter just talked about with all the news outlets and the interest, we've managed to share a lot of our preliminary findings already with the people on the islands, which is of vital importance. We look forward to continuing this outreach. We're doing that a bit with our newsletter, which you can see on the Kaitelvei website. We also have a list of people to whom we send that, people with whom we've worked on the islands, other people who are just interested in our research. And we think it's important to keep those lines, those bilateral lines of, or multilateral lines of communication open. So that's really what we wanted to say. We're available to talk with you in the break and answer questions or talk about more about our experiences. Thanks. Maybe now.
You're welcome to ask questions.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you have plenty of time, yeah. Okay, Niels.
Question in the back.
Hi, my name is Steffen Snelders from Utrecht University. I want to get back to the start of your presentation about distrust and sometimes outright hostility from local researchers and communities. We've done an other NW-funded project in Suriname over the past 4 years, which had kind of the same problems. So I would be interested in what kind of concrete strategies, tactics, viewpoints you adopted or developed in dealing with this, apart from having friendly times with some of these people.
Yeah, of course, some people will, like the Twitter person you saw a tweet from, will always remain angry. So those people, you can't do anything about that. But with others, we have really made an effort. And sometimes it remains a little bit strenuous, because sometimes we know that people stick to this attitude that most of the research should be done by the local island populations themselves and not by Dutch people coming from Holland to the islands. But on the other hand, also find that we are, I think, generally nice people, so nice to cooperate with. So some of the people who were hostile in the beginning, we've managed to become friends with, or at least have found a relationship with in which we can cooperate. Others, it's a little bit more difficult, but I should say that this is really a minority of the people on the islands who have reacted like that. So,
well, thanks for your talk. I really liked it. I have a question regarding the interdisciplinarity. I'm also in an interdisciplinary project with Elizabeth, who's sitting over here. And how do you go about making this project more than just multidisciplinarity, so having your separate project, but actually integrating them? Like you mentioned the article, are there other ways?
The big one thus far has been publication, and that's something we continue to work on. We're also, well, I think that's the most visible and the most obvious way, is to try to publish and get that knowledge out there. We are also doing that, where, for instance, we'll have a final conference for the whole project in which we bring all these perspectives together. Talking to each other a lot.
Yeah, that helps. And what also really helps is with the example of Will Johnson is that, of course, these are really small islands. So in a way, the people living there are very interdisciplinary, because Will Johnson is, of course, an island historian, is also a politician, and is very actively engaging with cultural heritage, which Stacy is working on. So he covers really the three disciplines that we are working on. So that also really helps to create more interdisciplinarity, maybe. But it has really been a challenge, and that's also the reason why we've listed it here.
Yeah, sorry for another question, but I was wondering, the people you talked to, you did not involve them in your application, so did they get any of the funding that you had?
No, so that was basically part of the problem. We received a big grant, we were going to the islands to do research there, so that was part of the complaint. Okay, you've received all this granting, all this money, and also, of course, because the Dutch Caribbean islands are non-sovereign political entities, they can't apply for Dutch funding, they can't apply for European funding, and they also can't apply for international funding. So that's... Okay, for European you can. Okay, so I was told that was not possible, but maybe it is. But so that's also part of the problem. We have, though, in various ways tried to also... So for example, for the survey which I organized and executed last year, we hired about 60 local interviewers, so in that way part of the money was redistributed to the islands, but they didn't receive part of our total grant in any formal way.
Just wait a second.
That's just actually, I think, not for you. Wait, let me introduce myself. Alana from Maastricht University. Is it possible to, let's say, transfer part of this funding to your partner organization for their cost, or does everything have to go directly through the Dutch institution?
Yes, I think I'm going to go into that a little bit when I discuss the technical details about the second call, because the first call really specifies on which categories you can spend your budget. And most of the budget, according to the normal NWO regulations, went to temporary scientific researchers appointed at the Dutch University of Dutch Knowledge Institutions. And a small part of the budget was available for spending on materials, technical support, for example, the people you used for the interviews. So that's more or less the way it worked in the first call for proposals. And we've tried, that's already getting ahead of myself, to change in the space we have to change a little bit for the second call.
Okay, thank you very much. From our experience, I come into the Caribbean for research regularly, and indeed, I think one recommendation is to try to involve the local organizations in your area of concern, in your field of interest, at an early stage in the proposal writing and everything, and that way you can avoid a lot of the sentiment that we heard you speak about. Okay, thank you very much. I would like to call forward Steven van Heuven, Alice Webb, and or Fleur van Duyl. I did see Fleur here in the room. Okay, Steven. Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Hello. Hey, that works. I'll try and leave the microphone there then. Hi, everyone. My name is Steven van Heuven. I'm a postdoctoral scientist at the Netherlands Institute for Sea Research. I'll be presenting what supposedly is a sexy and stimulating overview of the work that me and colleagues, both from NIOS and Demares, also with a student from University of Utrecht, have done in the Caribbean, looking at the anthropogenic effects on the state of the coral reef. Even though it's science, I guess that the talk itself is more of a picture show, but I guess that serves the purpose of making you enthusiastic about doing work in the Caribbean. The work will consist of two parts, both a seagoing part and work on one of the islands, on St. Eustatius. I'll briefly introduce the questions that we tried to answer or are in the process of answering, and then go through some imagery from both these sub-projects. And I will try to present you some preliminary results. So what you see on the right of the screen here, is this a pointer? Yes. Are two chunks of coral reef. Both are being invaded by what's called a sponge. A sponge is a filter feeding organism that exists in various shapes and sizes. These two particular types tend to bore into, they dig themselves into a chunk of coral reef as a house, essentially. They eat into it, but not for food, but for shelter, as it were. This degrades the coral reef. It removes calcium carbonate from the reef. And depending, of course, on how much a reef grows and how much the coral eats into it, a reef as a whole will grow or degrade. So there is this balance between production and loss of calcium carbonate. So as stable as a coral reef might seem, they do actually grow at rates that have been documented well over 10 kilograms of new material per square meter per year. So reefs can grow at a significant rate. However, sponges and other bioeroders, as they're called, can remove material, can eat it away, chip it away, etch it away at similar rates. So generally a coral reef would be considered to be sort of stable. However, there is a fear in the scientific community and observations from the field that this balance between production and loss might tip towards net loss of reef structure as a result of increasing acidity of seawater, the process of ocean acidification, due to uptake of CO2 from the atmosphere, but also the increased availability of nutrients in the seawater that can be sewage or agricultural runoff that triggers algal growth. All that floating organic material is food, for instance, for sponges. So in an environment that is more acidic to begin with, in which calcium carbonate tends to dissolve naturally with slightly more ease, and an environment where sponges can get a lot of food for free, more than they used to, they might degrade the corals faster than the coral reefs can keep up. So there are these questions about, do sponges really erode calcium carbonate faster in high CO2 and high food supply situations? And part of our proposal was to attempt to answer this doing manipulative experiments where we grow sponge coral assemblages and see how they do on the different scenarios. And we also very much would like to take, if you would, a baseline estimate of the state of the coral reef of the Sabre Bank, and see if that reef as a whole or the carbonate platform as a whole might be losing or gaining mass. Now that sounds rather arbitrary, the Sabre Bank, until you look at this map where this big yellow patch might look like an island, but the island's actually, so this is a depth map, sorry. So blue is very deep, yellow and red are shallow, and actually this tiny dot over here is the island of Sabre, here's Statia, that's St. Martin. And the Sabre Bank is this very, very massive carbonate platform that rises up from a kilometer deep ocean to just under the sea level, under the sea surface. And it hosts a very diverse coral assemblage on its eastern and southern end. And it gradually goes a bit deeper until it reaches the seafloor there. But this whole reef is at risk of degrading or possibly maintaining itself. So this is certainly not trivial. This is not just some bank, a little fringe reef around an island. It's a massive, it's the size of the province of Utrecht, I'm told. Something else that's special about this Sabre Bank is that it's offshore. It's not connected to an island. It's not around an island. It's well offshore, so it's not impacted as much by sewage discharge, agricultural runoff, etc., as many fringing reefs would be. Okay, the first part of the project, that's the sponge incubation. So our experiment consists of culturing sponges and corals and then exposing them to treatments and simply trying to see how aggressively the sponges dig into the coral and see if that changes as a response to the offered conditions. I'll skip over that second bit. So here's where the pictures start. This is us loading a sea container full of equipment. This was shipped last August, I believe, to Statia and arrived rather rapidly, we were surprised to find out. So we sent a lot of equipment, analyzers, aquaria tables, essentially everything that we thought we'd need and all the spare parts we thought we'd need, we shipped ourselves. And then we built this at the back of the seaside laboratory of the CNSI, the Caribbean Netherlands Science Institute on Statia. So it's three tables filled with aquaria, each fed with seawater from these blue barrels in which we can manipulate conditions. So these aquaria get different amounts of CO2 and water delivered to them. And then we had to fill them with sponges, so you get this very special permit that allows you to take a diamond coring drill to the reef and then you start coring out little bits of coral. So what you see here is a bit of dead coral reef, and it's completely overgrown with the sponge called Cliona caribea, which was our species of interest. Here you can see that we've dug out these little hockey pucks of coral material, and you bring them up. This, I guess, was the yield of a single dive, but this required many dives, and we drilled a great many holes. And then fill the aquaria. This is some of the control equipment that we built and used to maintain the conditions in these aquaria. This is one of the first results figures. This shows the four different treatments that we expose these the corals and sponges to. This shows a course of about 10 days, and you can see that part of our aquaria are fed from the barrel that has an increasing concentration of CO2. This is the condition that we would expect 100 years from now, given the business as usual economic development scenarios. And there's three lower treatments. The blue one is approximately what the ocean looks like now. The green one is approximately what the ocean looked like 50 years ago. So initially, there was a couple days of acclimatization where the sponge could get used to the new environment. And then there was the experimental phase, during which we actually tracked the behavior of the sponges. So this is more maintenance in swimming gear because there was water leaking everywhere. Everything was wet all the time. This is one of the incubations actually taking place. So the sponges are contained in these little plastic beakers with stirrer motors. And after 6 or 12 hours in these beakers, the water is collected and analyzed on instrumentation like this. So this is stuff we also shipped and set up locally. This is Paul Peters, a student of ours, closing samples for later analysis. And this is one of the very first figures that we've been able to produce, and it tentatively shows an increase of the rate of bioerosion, so the aggressiveness, if you would, of the sponges, as a result of increasing that CO2 concentration. We expect much higher quality results when we get the final chemical analyses. This is just from weighing the substrate. There's clear differences between day and night behavior of the sponges, but that's about as far as we got, and there's a lot of data, a lot of samples to still work up. Then the second part of a project is looking at the larger ecosystem, see if we can see carbonate dissolution or production in the field. And the first part of that was incubating small patch of the reef from a smaller diving vessel that we rented locally for a period of 2 weeks, 1 week of which we did this work. This is the thing seen from this side. And we set up an inflatable transparent tent at the bottom of the reef, and the idea is to enclose a volume of water so that any changes made to the water column by these processes, by the sponge growing or the coral reef dissolving, would be captured in those 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 liters of water in that tent rather than being mixed away into the water column. So we incubate the community and try and see changes under the tent. Here's a very little movie that shows how that actually looks like in practice. So the tent's inflatable. And there's a bunch of divers connecting a pump to the tent, and very gradually it builds up. They work over the sand now, not to damage the coral reef, of course. And as soon as the tent is rigid, they transplant it to the reef, which is in the corner there. And then it gets hammered down. There's a big hammer here. It gets hammered into the substrate, and there's steel change all on it. And then it just sits there for several days, and every couple of hours we collect samples and analyze them partly as they come in. Part of them are sealed and brought back to Holland, so we're awaiting several hundreds of liters of water to come in one of these weeks. From some of the things that we've done in the field, we've generated a few figures that I won't go into detail of, except maybe for this one that shows us opening and closing the tent over a course of 3 days. It's day one, day two, day three. And you can see in white, when the tent is open, the concentration of, in this case, oxygen is rather stable over time. As soon as we close the tent, the oxygen concentration starts to decrease. So then suddenly you do see that there is an active community in the tent. If you don't give them outside water, they start to suffocate themselves. So after a while, we open it up, it restores the background concentrations, and then when we close it, it drops again. So coincident with these oxygen data, we have all sorts of carbonate system measurements, nutrient measurements, and altogether we hope to pry from that a signal of calcium carbonate dissolution or production, and that should give us, at least for that little patch of coral, it should give us an overview of, or an idea of the status of the reef, if you would. So more work is just doing more of that work, write up and preparing for a cruise on a proper research vessel in autumn of this year on the Dutch RV Pelagia, where we'll do similar work, although without divers, so we have to somehow have to automate this or do another type of measurement that gives us the same sort of insights, except on an even larger scale. So we go from organism to the whole saber bank in the course of a year, approximately. That's where we are now. Are there any questions?
Thank you very much. We have space for one question. Really quick question. Yes, Ronald.
I was wondering what is the pH of the natural waters around Ceiba and St. Eustatius?
It's always 8. That's the safe answer. The pH, I, without having looked at it, I would say it's between 7.95 and 8.05.
So I would consider that on the lower side of average. I think average is 8.1.
It depends strongly on where you look, but I believe seawater around the world is between 7.9 and 8.1, yeah, and it has gone down 0.2 of a pH unit over the last century. Certainly in our tent, conditions could become a little more extreme. During the incubation, you would, and we do see a measurable drop in pH that restores as soon as we open the tent up again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now have on our program a video message from Johan Stapel at the CNSE.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It is my pleasure to address you at this launch event of the Caribbean Programme, a multidisciplinary approach of the Netherlands Organization for Scientific Research. I thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present to you in this way the Caribbean Netherlands Science Institute at St. Eustatius, CNSI. My name is Johan Stapel. I am the director of CNSI. I run this facility together with Pepita Kannagieter, our administration assistant, and Marcel Spanger, our research assistant.
I am sorry that I cannot be with you today in Leiden. At this moment, we teach a summer school on sustainable coastal management, which is the first summer school in a series of 3 on small island natural resource development. The participants in this summer school come from St. Eustatius, Bonaire, Aruba, St. Martin, Puerto Rico, Trinidad and Tobago, Haiti, Nevis, Antigua, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, Grenada, St. Lucia, Jamaica, Belize and the Netherlands, and consist of researchers, nature managers, government officials and private companies. The multitude of people and their different backgrounds shows the interest for, in this case, coastal zone management throughout the Caribbean. Together, we are witnessing this launch event through a live video stream. Many of the participants are interested in this Caribbean program and the possibilities it may offer to participate and to cooperate with Dutch researchers. The Caribbean Netherlands Science Institute is a facility in support of research, science, outreach and education, in short, knowledge development and capacity building, located at the Caribbean Netherlands island of St. Eustatius. The Institute has a multifunctional objective and offers support for research and outreach for a wide range of disciplines relevant to the Caribbean region and primarily focuses on issues that are relevant for the sustainability of tropical small island economies. Scientific disciplines include culture, nature, geology and oceanography, history, nature management, agriculture, archaeology, etc. CNSI is part of the knowledge infrastructure of St. Eustatius and the Caribbean Netherlands, but has the ambition to develop into an institute acknowledged in the wider Caribbean region, positioned at the intersection of research, science, education, governance and management. On the first floor, CNSI offers meeting rooms, workspace, and exposition space to its guests and to its users. Building on a small library of grey and scientific literature relevant to the Caribbean region. Records in the library are mostly donations. The library also functions as office space for Pepita. Pepita is able to help you with administrative issues and ICT support. On the second floor, CNSI offers accommodation for visitors. CNSI offers a communal kitchen, and we are now building a second kitchen. Rooms consist of two dormitories for maximum 6 persons each and 5 two-person bedrooms in which we could place extra bunk beds if needed. All rooms have air conditioning, shower and toilet. There is a laundry facility and there are porches for our guests to relax with a nice view on the Quill volcano and the sunset over the Caribbean Sea. If you are lucky, you could see a green or even a blue flash. In addition, CNSI offers laboratory space with basic laboratory equipment, a nutrient analyzer operated by another spanner, and other facilities specified on our website. CNSI offers an outdoor mesocosm facility with running seawater for marine experiments. CNSI can also make use of test fields, for instance for agricultural experiments. CNSI has several storage containers that can be used by visitors. The front porch offers a place for outside meetings and is also a parking place for CNSI bicycles that can be used by our guests. We also have a car and a small research vessel to go around. We can assist renting other means of transportation if needed. CNSI also functioned as meeting place for visitors and the general public of St. Eustatius. Every third Thursday of the month, CNSI's Science Café is to enjoy an informal get-together of CNSI guests and residents and visitors of St. Eustatius to inspire and engage each other in discussions and networking opportunities and to get informed about topical scientific research and local station knowledge.
An administrator, come and help this man get back his money back. Don't let this woman fool your home station, man. Hey, Bounder, what did you run away? Come! Bounder, what did you run away? What did you run away?
CNSI wants to create a fertile basis for scientific curiosity and the development of an academic culture. And how better than to start by involving the young people and reaching out to the schools on the island. Research vessel Pelagia visited St. Eustatius 2 times and welcomed school children on board. Since its opening in April 2014, CNSI has supported more than 50 projects and activities. In 2015 alone, the Institute received 125 different guests, bachelors, masters and PhD students, postdocs and senior researchers in age ranging between 18 and 80, who together stayed well over 3,000 nights at the Institute. A considerable part of the research in the projects that is presented to you today made use of our facilities and support and enjoyed the beautiful nature of the island, above and below water. Thank you. CNSI is made possible by the cooperation between the Institute for Marine Resources and Ecosystem Studies of Wageningen University and Research Center, the Archaeology Faculty of the University of Leiden, the Royal Netherlands Institute for Southeast Asian and Caribbean Studies, KITLV, Naturalis Biodiversity Center, the Royal Netherlands Institute for Sea Research, the Ardent Government of Sint Eustatius, the Netherlands Organization for Scientific Research, NWO, and the Ministry of Education, Culture and Science.
Well, thank you very much, Johan.
We look forward to welcoming you at our institute.
Thank you, Johan. It was a very nice presentation, and it's great to see this innovative use of the biodiversity of an island, not only to look at, but also to derive information from and involve the local population. Thank you, and good luck with the CNSI. Folks, I see that we have a break for you right now, and I highly recommend you to take a look at the posters in the back. We'll be back here in 15 minutes. Let me see. In half an hour. Yes. Okay, we have here Katharina Josen, and she will be speaking about Caribbean women and crime.
Thank you.
The floor is yours.
Thanks. So I'm already introduced. So I'm the postdoc on the project Caribbean Women and Crime. This project actually came from a different project we did before with the same team that was about incarcerated women in the Netherlands and their life histories. And in that project, we came across the fact that a large part of the women incarcerated in the Netherlands were born in the Dutch Caribbean. And even though women that are incarcerated often have very extreme negative life experiences, the Dutch Caribbean women often reported lower values on all those experiences. So from that study, we couldn't really see what the causes were for their incarceration. So that is really why we came with this study. Our team consists of myself and Annemarie Slotboom and Katrien Beideveld. We have an advisory board for the study that consists of Helen van der Wal. She is a member of the board of advisors of Aruba. Paula Kibbelaar, she works at the Instituto Pedagogica of Aruba. And Candice Krutschnitz, she's a professor on gender studies in Canada. Peter van der Laan, he's does a lot of work in probation services. And Geert-Jan Stams also has done a lot of work in the Caribbean from the UvA. We have two local coordinators overseeing the data collection. Luc-Celeste Johannes, he is working on Curaçao, and Rochelaine Geerman from Aruba. I won't go into too much detail about the contents of the study, like the previous presenters also said. If there's questions about that, it's easier to email me. So I'm really focusing shortly on the research question and our sample, and then I'll talk a bit about our approach of setting up the study and how far we are at this moment, and something about our successes and challenges in the process. And so the research question is, how is offending among Dutch Caribbean women predicted by a combination of sociological and psychological variables, and in what way are these risk factors interrelated? So within that research question, we specifically look at the role of attachments to both society and individuals, such as parents, friends, partners, children, and also how the disruption of such attachments through, for example, migration, are potentially related to the risk for offending. To answer this research question, it's really important, and I always emphasize this, that we do not only interview and have respondents that have been in contact with the criminal justice system or have been incarcerated, but we also need a control group of women that have not been in contact with the criminal justice system. So a general population of women that have more normal lives so that we can compare. So it's not that all the women that we approach for our study, we say, you probably have been in contact with the criminal justice system. No, to see what are risk factors we need to be able to compare between the ones that have and have not been in contact with the criminal justice system. We do this opposed to existing studies that, for example, have a Dutch native sample and then compare this sample on various risk factors with several ethnic minorities such as Surinamese, Dutch Caribbean, Turkish and Moroccan ethnic minorities. With this study, we really try to see within a group of Caribbean women what are the differences in life experience between the group that has been in contact with the criminal justice system and the group that has not been in contact. So to do that, we have a sample, or we want to have a sample of a total of 400 women, of which 300 non-incarcerated women, so general population, that were born in the Dutch Caribbean, so one of the six islands in the Dutch Caribbean, and are currently living in the Netherlands, Aruba or Curaçao. So we collect the data only in three locations, but women from all the countries are actually included in the sample. And next to those 300, we have 100 women that were born in the Dutch Caribbean that are currently incarcerated, either in the Netherlands, Aruba, or Curaçao. it's important that all the women are interviewed in the same way. So we collect the same data for all women. We use an adult attachment measure, a life history calendar that's really extensive, and a questionnaire. We control, for example, for parental birth country, and track, for example, all migration movements throughout the entire life course on a yearly basis, which we can really put in a nice view on the calendar. We do that also for different variables, such as living situation, relationships, partners, children, parenthood, work, income, substance abuse, etc. What we will do also in the questionnaire is that we have different measures of delinquent behavior. So we ask if they've been incarcerated, we ask if they've been arrested, if they have committed offenses that they were not in contact with the justice system for. We also have a questionnaire about minor delinquent acts. And for the analysis, we will form groups based on the score. So not as much how we approach the women, sort of outside versus inside of prison, but more on what they report. So it is possible that the women that we approached as a general population have actually been incarcerated years before. So then, based on the scores, we will divide the groups and we will do the analyses. So the approach that we took consists of four steps. Step one was connecting with key stakeholders locally as well as in the Netherlands. To do this, we aim to present a study to as many stakeholders that we could think of. In doing so, we wanted to introduce the project, explain the research question, the aim, the methodology, also our intentions, our good intentions, especially as researchers on this very sensitive topic, and to gain as well as much feedback at that stage from local expertise, researchers and practitioners. So we have really tried to be as open as possible for critique, feedback, criticism, to be able to incorporate that as much as we could at that stage to develop the final methodology for the study. What we also did in the presentations is to emphasize the opportunity to collaborate on publications, for example. So we really emphasized that the whole data set would be online available afterwards for other researchers to write proposals to use the data, either with their own network or together with us. of course, to do that online database, it has to be anonymized, so we also emphasize that. And we also emphasized that our aim was to present the results locally after the study was finalized, so that the results would flow back, for example, to the Caribbean. through the established network that we set up during the first visits to both Aruba and Curaçao, we set out a vacancy for local interviewers. It was very important for us to not import interviewers, but really have interviewers from Curaçao and Aruba. Also because of the language, of course, that it is really important if you ask about sensitive topics that people can talk in their preferred language. And a second visit was then planned to give an extensive 5-day training. And after that, the most successful candidates were selected for the data collection. The data collection is still ongoing at this point. So in the Netherlands, we have done 75 interviews of the 200, of which 27 in prison. So of course, especially in prison, the data collection is a bit slower because there's not always enough women at that point that we haven't interviewed yet. So they trickle in, so to speak. And in Curaçao, we've also done 30 interviews, of which 9 in prison. And in Aruba, we have done 30 interviews, not yet in prison. In Aruba, there is a very low percentage of women incarcerated that are actually born in the Dutch Caribbean. Most of the women that are incarcerated there are, for example, from Venezuela or from the Dominican Republic or other Latin American countries. So that is a bit more challenging. So far, a third of the data has been collected. And after that, we are very keen to present our results, of course. So I will talk a little bit about the successes and challenges we had. I was very happy that Wouter already presented, because I had some of similar, similar experiences, yeah. So in the first step, we did manage to present the results to a wide variety of key stakeholders. We also had some interviews with the media, for example, in Curaçao. About the project, we talked to the University of Curaçao, to IPA, to the, some staff of the University of Aruba, the Ministry of Justice, both on Curaçao and Aruba, the Prison of Curaçao, Probation Services, Central Bureau of Statistics, Youth and Family Centers, women organizations such as ASEDA, for example, on Curaçao, the representation of the Netherlands, Aruba House, Addiction Services, Victim Aids, the Commission of Children's Rights in Curaçao. So we really tried a very broad arena of stakeholders to get them familiarized with our study. We did find in these presentations, or I found giving those presentations, that there was a lot of criticism as well, and initial sort of resistance towards especially the topics that we included in the study. For example, because we look at parent-child relationships, we look at partner violence, poverty, racism, offending, those are really, all of them are sensitive. So I really gave as much effort as possible to explain our intentions with including those topics, how important it is to actually study those topics to be able to make changes at all. For example, one of the sensitive topics was harsh discipline, or physical discipline, and versus a child abuse. There's a very difficult gray area, so to speak, of acts that in the Netherlands would be labeled as child abuse, which are really seen as discipline strategies that are normal, for example, in Curaçao and Aruba. So how do you study those behaviors without labeling them? So you really have to have you have to sort of ask for the behavior without saying, we think that is child abuse. So we tried to put a lot of effort into making our questionnaire and our calendar friendly to various opinions about such discipline strategies. Furthermore, like Wouter also says, that we had limitations in the budget. So in connecting to the universities, it was difficult. I'm almost done. to get them to cooperate because we couldn't pay for their staff. So that's why we now have coordinators that are unpaid, which is really difficult to ask of people, but we're very happy that they were willing to help us after all anyway. So in training the interviewers, we did find very successful interviewers in both Aruba and Curaçao, but the difficulty is in keeping them motivated from a distance. So I can't supervise them as intensively as I do with my students and interviewers in the Netherlands. So it's difficult to retain all of them and keep the data collection going as fast as you would like. So that said, we do hope to finalize the data collection by the end of August as planned, and then hope to present the results in the next presentation.
Thank you very much, Catalina. One question. We'll allow one question. I've been instructed to stand in the center,
so that I get picked up by the camera. Okay. Yes, go ahead.
What is your hypothesis? What do you think that is the reason of being incarcerated by Caribbean women? That is different than
That's a Dutch very women. Difficult question. I think it's also a very broad question. It would have been nice if I could have presented my whole theoretical framework for the study. Like I said, we look at the role of attachment. So my hypothesis on that front would be that, for example, insecure attachment among Dutch Caribbean women increases the risk for offending. And we want to see how, for example, insecure attachment is related to other risk factors such as poverty, partner violence, single motherhood, etc.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Okay. So welcome, everyone. Thank you for being here, and thank you for the organizers to allow me to talk to you today about the effect of human land use on species communities of the Dutch Caribbean. My name is Wendy, and I'm a first-year PhD student, well, starting my second year at the Vrije Universiteit Amsterdam within the NWO-sponsored project Island Biogeography Meets the Anthropocene. So when people think of Caribbean islands, they probably will imagine something like this, these beautiful specks of paradise isolated from the mainland. And of course, most of you all know that the Caribbean is actually really beautiful, but this ideal image is not completely accurate anymore. Because islands are affected by our activities, and since the Western colonization of the Caribbean, we've actually altered the island's environments. Because we've reduced the amount of natural area on these islands, and we've reduced the isolatedness of these islands through our increasing intensity of travel and trade throughout the Caribbean. And basically, my entire PhD revolves around the question, how do these human activities influence the biodiversity that we find on these islands? So to really start to tackle this question, you basically have to know there are different types of species on islands. You have native species that have evolved on these islands, have sometimes been there for millions of years, and have actually adapted to the pristine natural area on islands. On the other hand, you have exotic species that are coming along with these boats and planes that we use, and they don't have any evolutionary history to our to these new islands, basically. So in this talk, I really want to know whether exotic species and native species are equally affected by human land use, because these exotics are, for instance, coming into this system often in very anthropogenically impacted areas around ports and very urbanized areas. So there are indications that exotic species and native species are actually differentially affected by human land use. For instance, the St. Martin skink is locally extirpated from this island. There are no individuals found anymore. And one of the main drivers of this local extinction might have been land use change. On the other end, you have an invasive plant species, Coralita, especially on St. Eustatius, a very big problem. And this plant actually seems to really utilize this disturbed anthropogenic habitat for its establishment as well as spread. So basically, why we want to know whether local distributions of exotics and natives are related to human land use is actually if we know that, then there's the basis of managing the establishment of exotic species, as well as the protection of the often unique native biodiversity on islands. So that's why, at the start of my PhD, I wanted to answer these questions. Are native and exotic species distributions related to various levels of human land use? And how does human land use affect your overall species richness within the species communities? So to answer these questions, this summer I went to two Dutch Caribbean islands, the island of St. Eustatius and the island of St. Martin. These islands are very close in proximity to each other, as well as in their climate, but they're very different, as you can already see, in the degree of human land use, the intensity of it. And then, of course, you need a species group to study. And I selected the group of amphibians and reptiles. They are very diverse in terms of their morphology, but they're also very abundant within the Caribbean islands. They're easy to spot. And they have already shown that they are affected by human activities, because there are a lot of exotic establishment known of these species in the Caribbean, and also about a third of the herpetofauna of these species is endangered with extinction. So we went to these islands and we identified different habitats there that are actually located on both islands. You have forest, shrub, and urban areas. And I identified different subcategories that are defined by the amount of human impact within them. So I'll show you all of these. Basically, on the top panel, you see forest habitat. Well, everyone knows what a forest looks like. Very tall trees, thick litter layer. And on the lower panel, you see extensive shrubland. And within these categories, you have areas that are built, that have, for instance, old ruins and plantation walls in them, that have debris in them, have fences in them. And I identified these areas as forest impact and shrub impact. And in urban areas, you also have very well-defined categories. You have these very lush irrigated gardens. You have built sites in which the dominant structures are complete buildings. And you have these rubble plots that are often cleared areas. They're dumped sites, and basically they're recolonized by native species. And so the 3D structure and the vegetation structure of these urban areas is completely defined by humans. And that these categories are actually, that these categories are actually significantly different in terms of their human land uses visible in these graphs. So for upright structures, you see that the highest degree of upright structures are in the built sites. They're often located in urban sites. And upright structures is actually the defining variable in terms of identifying forest impact from the pristine and shrub impact from the pristine areas. And also for roads, you see that in urban areas, you have more paved roads, very intensely used roads. And this is actually pretty similar over the more pristine areas of the island. So let's go back to the questions that I posed earlier. Are the native and exotic distributions related to the degree of human land use on these islands? And actually, they are. Here is the results for Statia. You see that actually native species are not so restricted to only natural area. Actually, of all native species that are recorded, they're about a third in a forest area, about a third in shrub area, and about a third in urban area. However, for exotic species, all of them were found in urban area. And this trend is exactly the same for St. Martin, which is really nice because the degree of human land use is very different. But within these distinct habitats, you see, again, this equal distribution of natives, and most of the exotics found in urban area. Some have actually penetrated into the shrub area, but again, most are in the impacted subcategory. When you look at the overall effect of human land use on the species number that we find in the different habitat types, we actually didn't really find significant results within forest and within shrub the categories. However, if you pool these together, you see again the species richness, so the species number you find in urban areas is highest on both islands. And of course, this is pretty logical because you see that both natives and exotics are pooling together in this urban area. So based on these results, I can say that human land use actually significantly influences the species communities of the Dutch Caribbean. Because I've shown you that exotic species are almost exclusively found in impacted locations, the native species are actually not only restricted to these pristine habitats like I hypothesized before, but they co-occur in urban areas. And this causes the pooling of these species in urban areas and maximizing species richness there. So basically, this is all a first step towards a predictive framework of island biodiversity in the future. And from these results, my main message is anthropogenic habitat plays a crucial role in the establishment of exotic species in oceanic islands, so we can actually start to predict what will happen in the future. So this research is, of course, not possible without the aid of local institutes, conservationists, rangers, and that have helped us tremendously identifying these habitats and going into the field. But they also gave us the opportunity to really start a dialogue with the local inhabitants of these islands. Of course, through Science Cafe, we already saw that, via Johan Stapel, that really allows us to show the background, the scientific background of my project. But I also, on both islands, aided in summer school, in which we really showed the children how amazing the local biodiversity is on these islands, which was amazing to see how proud they actually are on their environment. And also, this resulted in the fact that they also asked us questions back, and we're now setting up new projects on Stacia to really tackle new questions that we actually based on results that we found there. So that's really great. And I would hereby like to thank my field team, as well as the academic team that are working to me on this grant. My supervisor, Jacinta Ellers, as well as my advisors, Jocelyn Bam and Matt Helmes, that have all co-authored the NWO grant. My sponsors, and thank you all for listening.
Thank you very much. We can take a few questions. Okay, Eric.
Thank you. I have one question which is related to the effect of time. How do you include the effect of the past? I mean, human population was very different in Stacia, about 10 times as many people and a lot of more shipping. So the distribution of species is probably influenced by what happened in the past. And also, if you want to predict, isn't it possible that the distribution that you see now is just an one step in time of the distribution of those, of the expansion of those exotic species? So they might just expand outside of those rural urban areas in a few years. And how do you include that in your research?
Yeah, it's very difficult to include that in my research. Of the exotic introductions on Stacia, the only ones that are known have occurred during the time of the slave trade. So that's a couple of hundred years back. On St. Martin, there are a lot of new animals that have come into the system since the intensification of trade. Basically, what we thought would happen is that for the old introductions, they would be everywhere because Stacia is so small. And the amount of anthropogenic habitat there was a lot bigger than it's now. However, we didn't find, of course, it could be a species retraction of its range. That's true. We don't know that because there are not a lot of there's not a lot of information, archaeological information about bones distributed across the island, and that's very difficult. So I think the most logical explanation for the range of these species right now is not a retraction of its range, but the lack of invading the other areas. And that could, of course, have to do with other environmental variables and not only land use. So we recorded other variables as well. But we don't see any evidence of that happening.
Thank you very much, Wendy. Okay, our next speaker is going to be Niels van den Berg, and he's going to tell us about the technical details relating to this second call for proposals.
First of all, I'm very happy to see so many people interested in this call for proposals and the Caribbean research in general. I work at the Earth and Life Sciences Department at NWO. Together with my colleague Josef Stoffer, we've prepared this second call for proposals and this event. He unfortunately cannot be here. Most of you probably know him from the previous call, but he has a really good reason because he became a dad yesterday, so that's a good excuse to not be here. I would like to thank Naturalis for providing this really nice location, and also I would like to thank the program committee for all their help in all the preparations of this call for proposals. I'm not alone here from NWO. I have a colleague from Earth and Life Sciences here in the front, so if you have some questions later, you can also ask Martijn Los. And there's a colleague from the Social Sciences Department, Anne, she's here in the front also, so you can also speak to her. So I'll walk you through some of the technical details briefly. The details you can find in the call of proposal, which was published on Tuesday. Maybe some of you already downloaded it. First, a little bit of background. So as most of you already know, the Caribbean Research Program and the CNSI Institute were funded in 2012 by the Ministry of Education, Culture and Science, with a duration of 5 years. So for now, this is the last call of proposals within this program. Earth and Life Sciences Division is responsible for developing this call for proposals and executing it, but we're supported by humanities and social sciences. And today, it was discussed already, especially also in the presentation of Peter, which were the main aims of the research proposal. And this was the basis, the starting point, together with the feedback we got from the ministry and stakeholders in the Caribbean, to sharpen the scientific context, which was already presented, but also we've introduced some new elements in the call, especially related to facilitate and stimulate more the active collaboration with partners on the Caribbean, and to make possible that they can really be involved in the programs. The total budget for this call of proposals is about 4.6 million euros. And I will walk you through the procedure and the timeline. Most people who are familiar with NWO calls will be familiar with this timeline. So the publication of the call for proposals was on Tuesday. You can find it on our website. So the program website has a link to it. And you can also go directly to the funding page. You can also find the application form there already. The deadline for submitting proposals in our new application system, ESAC, is by the end of May. The application is still not open yet. We're planning to do this next week. So if you're really, really fast, you still have to wait a little bit. After receiving all the proposals, we will check the eligibility of the proposals, then we will send it out for peer review by international experts. The applicants will get the opportunity to respond to these reviews by writing a rebuttal directed to the assessment committee. This international assessment committee will probably gather in September. They will evaluate the programs and come up with a ranking, and this ranking, the Board of Earth and Life Sciences will come to a final funding decision. The projects will have to start 6 months after receiving the funding letter. The deadline for submitting proposals is fixed. The other plan of the procedure might change in details, but this is at least the general view. Then, who can apply? Most of you are familiar with NWO calls. Know that as a principal applicant, you have to be a researcher for a Dutch university or NWO-recognized knowledge institute, and this researcher can act as the principal applicant of the proposal on behalf of a consortium. So this a person will be responsible for the scientific content and also the financial planning of the project. This year, we have come up with an additional requirement. This is that the there has to be at least one primary pro-Caribbean partner, not-for-profit organization, in each proposal. The researchers from other Dutch research institutes can act as a co-applicant, and of course the same requirements for them apply as for the principal applicant. And any additional consortium partner is welcome. So this can be not-for-profit or profit from a Caribbean organization, a Dutch organization, or any other part of the world. We will ask for a letter of commitment from all the partners, and it also has to be clear in each proposal that each partner is actively involved in setting up the proposal and also in executing the proposal. When I'm talking about a Caribbean partner or a Caribbean, I mean the six islands within the Dutch kingdom. Then I'll go to the next slide. None of them work, so I'll just do it here on the screen. What can be applied for? For each proposal, a maximum of 600,000 euros can be asked. And this funding can be used for two categories, personnel costs and material costs. And here also we have some new elements, because in general NWO calls, and also especially for Earth and Life Science, we're used for personnel costs to only have category A. 60 to 80% of the total budget has to go to personnel costs. The first category are temporary scientific staff at Dutch institutions, so this is the principal applicant or co-applicants, and these are PhD students or postdocs. And there has to be at least one of these positions within the project. Then the second position, which is new in this call, we introduced this to also make it possible to have a PhD or postdoc at a university knowledge institution on a Caribbean island. This, of course, requires that the Caribbean University can provide for the promotion trajectory. And the principal applicant will provide with the salary cost to the contracting institution on the Caribbean. Then the third category is also, because we've heard in a lot of presentations that it was really difficult to involve local people in the project because we couldn't fund them. So we've added category three, which is other personnel based on the Caribbean at a not-for-profit organization. And this could be people helping in field work, but also people really giving a contribution to the project over the whole period. And we have a minimum a demand here of an effort of 0.2 FTE over the duration of the project. And with the equivalent, I mean that this could be also be concentrated in a shorter period, or it could be more people all contributing to the same project, as long as it adds up to minimal 0.2 FTE over the duration of the project. Of course, if the budget can be distributed in a way that it can be increased, the researchers are free to do that. Last category, the bench fee, which is provided for the PhD and postdoc researchers. Then the second category of material costs. These are costs for equipment and consumables that are necessary to carry out the research project, which with a maximum of 25% of the total personnel costs. There are travel costs for the consortium partners, for the non-profit consortium partners, maximum of 10% of the total budget. And then the third category is capacity development, knowledge sharing, outreach, so to develop courses, to give workshops, to organize events, to do outreach, and this has to be budgetized with 5 or 10% of the total budget. So there's a minimum there also. Then the evaluation criteria, there are two main criteria, and they're equally as important. So the first criteria is originality and scientific quality. So innovative aspects, quality of the proposal, quality of the consortium. In the call text, they will be specified a little bit more. The second category is regional relevance and impact and capacity development. So this will be equally as important as the first category. Relevance for the Caribbean islands, fit to the thematic context and urgency, potential for application in Caribbean, short term, long term, quality of the collaboration and the strategy for capacity development and outreach, and the potential for long-term knowledge relations. This brings me to the end of my presentation. Please check our program page for updates around the program itself. So, for example, a video of this day will also be provided there. And for the call for proposals, you can go to the funding page. You can find the call, the application form, and as I mentioned, the link for application will be there shortly. If you have any questions after today, please email us. We have a general email address for this program. Joseph and I will both be reading that, or you can just call us directly. And I hope to see a lot of nice proposals in this round. Hopefully not 120, because then we would be really busy, because today I think there were 120 people registered. Good luck with coming up with nice plans, and if you have any questions, I can have answer some of them now and otherwise later on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Niels. We can handle a few questions here. We have 5 minutes for questions. Yes.
My name is Martine Bouwman, the director of the Center for Media and Health and endowed professor at the Erasmus University. And I have a suggestion, not a question, but a suggestion. I see a lot of interesting projects presented here. And my suggestion would be, when we talk about the 5 or 10% of knowledge sharing and outreach, it would be interesting to ask all the researchers of the future projects to make film fragments of all their project, because I think everybody in the islands is interested in what's happening on the islands. And they don't read our articles, they don't read things. But if you can make film fragments, shootings of your project during 1 or 2, 3 years and make small clips, then it would be also for NVO interesting to put them on the website. And I try to put this on the agenda for a long time, and maybe it's time to do it now in this next round. So I would like to have a short discussion maybe afterwards or by telephone. That's a suggestion.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. More questions or suggestions? I'll start here.
Maybe I missed it, but what's the duration of the research project?
The duration, minimal is 2 years for a postdoc, if you only have one postdoc, but I think most projects will take benefit of the possibilities, and then the maximum is 5 years, which is the maximum extent of a PhD when it's not full-time. So a normal PhD would be 4 years, full-time, and that's about it.
Are there any restrictions about spending money on non-Dutch Caribbean islands?
Yes. You cannot.
None at all?
No.
Okay.
It has to be based on a Caribbean island within the Kingdom of the Netherlands.
But sometimes you want to make comparisons. Like endemism, for example.
Oh.
You can't know about
No, I guess you can include other ideas in your project, but you cannot, for example, the personnel costs, they cannot be spent outside of the Netherlands. But if it's material costs that you would use for field work, and you would have part of your field work on Curaçao and part on another island to do a comparative study, I think if you can make a good proposal with that, that it's possible to do that.
Related to the last question, are proposals that partly deal with Suriname eligible?
Could you speak up a little bit?
Proposals that partly deal with Suriname, are they eligible for funding?
If proposals that partly... with Suriname. Well, the main focus in the scientific context is on the Dutch Caribbean islands. So the main focus should be the Dutch Caribbean islands. And if you can explain this very well, but then if in your project there's a comparable study or same topics are relevant for Suriname, I guess this can be valuable and it could be possible.
Any more questions? Okay. Back. I'll get the gentleman in the back first and then I'll come to you. And then we'll be done.
Hi, my name is Martijn Riekes, TU Delft. I have a question. You have to have one primary Caribbean partner.
Yes.
Not for profit. So what kind of partner is this? Is this the university or is it hotel management?
this can be university, so knowledge institution. It could be governmental. It could be an NGO.
Okay, so for example, TNO Caribbean is also could be a partner, for example.
I'll have to look into that because I don't know if TNO is like registered in the Netherlands or in the Caribbean. I'm not sure.
Okay, thank you.
Hello. I would like to ask whether there's room to include a partner in the consortium who also delivers extra funding. And if yes, would that also increase the chances for getting the funding?
Well, it's no evaluation criteria. Of course, it's great if you can find a partner in your consortium that is so interested in your project that they want to contribute in cash or in kind, and I think you can. And if you describe it, you will probably be able to describe a better consortium construction, and the knowledge sharing and utilization will probably be stronger than another proposal. I don't think the referees and the committee will think, oh, this is a good proposal because there's extra money. No, it has to have an added value.
Thank you very much, Niels. Any further questions regarding technical issues, please feel free to take contact with Niels or Josef later. And after the session has ended, you're also free to ask Niels any further questions you may have. Right now, I'd like to invite Yvonne van der Peil and Giselle Starink-Marta up to speak about imagining the nation in the classroom. To belong or not to belong.
Good afternoon. Thanks for having me here. My name is Yvonne, and I'm, I think, the least important of the whole project, but we decided I was the presenter today. But Giselle is also here over there, and if you have any questions afterwards, we will be here at the drinks. What I want to do, and our other team members are actually in the field at the moment. What I want to do is just briefly say something about our project. And I will do that by referring to our website. And also briefly, because lots of things have already been said, which is very good, I think, about some findings and experience at the moment in
our project still going on. Just to say something about the project, we're working with two PhD students. They are at the moment in the field, and one you can see it yourself, and one postdoc project, and actually, can I go? Just put it back. I kind of work because I can't see it on the screen, but the main aim of the study is actually to understand the ways in which pupils in secondary and primary schools actually imagine different ways of belonging within the Dutch Caribbean. Two ethnographic fieldwork PhD students are at the moment working on St. Martin and Statia. One of the main findings at the moment, actually using the idea of doing ethnography, is that we decided to do anthropological long-term fieldwork. So now two of our PhD students are working in classrooms at different schools in the different islands with children together, also with teaching assistants from the University of St. Martin. What we realized is that this is maybe a good methodology to really have the commitment with, it has been said all the time, with the people you are working with, not studying on or about. Very preliminary at the moment, one of the main findings on how children at schools trying to make home on these islands or trying to imagine and create a sense of belonging is very much related to conditions of hypermobility, extreme movements, the plurality of backgrounds, cultural, national, ethnic, religious, the issue of diversity in languages, which actually relates to very pragmatic manners of relating to each other, relating to the islands, relating to family, relating to education. One of the observations, very broad and very preliminary, is that diversity actually is everywhere. So just to cite one of our PhD students, children grow up within extended families with ties across many oceans. Many of them grow up in movement between islands, between family members, between different languages and ideas. But also, and this is very important to note, with regard to education and educational policy, many of their teachers have a background from another island. They are coming from abroad, and also the material that has been used and that has been that is used in the different schools is a kind of a mixture of all kinds of different materials from all kinds of different educational systems, and also the majority of the teachers at the moment is not staying for a very long time in the different classrooms at different schools. So the whole issue of mobility and movement is coming into the classroom by material, by children themselves with different ethnic, religious, transnational backgrounds, by their families, but also the material they work with and the curriculum they are faced with. In on a very concrete level, and it was already mentioned also as a important topic maybe in the second call, is the issue of language and the issue of very different languages at the islands, in the school, and in the educational system. And actually, at the moment, this has our attention a lot, that, for example, on St. Martin, there is a choice between having the first language of instruction in standard English or Dutch. And there is this idea that parents or family members or children themselves can make a choice between these different languages, whereas, of course, the situation at home might be very different. Dutch is not spoken at home all the time, but still parents will choose for a school in which the
instruction language is Dutch. I think we all have read the evaluation report that has been presented last October. And when we look at the specific ideas about education, it has been the idea that actually this year all pupils at different islands must be at the standard of having access to education either in the European Netherlands or in North America. So choosing between a language of instruction in schools that is appropriate to have this further career. In reality, that is not the case. And actually, the norm at the moment might be very mythical. The reality on the islands actually undercuts how the educational policy from The Hague at the moment still is thought out. Well, that's part of what we are sensing at the moment. Doing ethnography means being in the field, being there, working in this case with the children in the different schools. Something about doing research, again, and it has been said in different presentations, and I think actually this is will be my main point. I was visiting the different islands and our PhD students last autumn, and I stayed for a while, visited different islands, and actually I was really shocked by the overload of researchers, of administrators, of policymakers, of students, master students, undergraduate students, PhD students that were for one reason or the other on the islands. And the reaction of the people is increasingly, I think, defensive. So, one, according to doing research, that means that we really, really have to think about in what way we want to do our research, so in terms of methodology. So now for example, try to commit ourselves in the field for a very long time. So our PhD students started in August to be in the classroom the whole year round. That's an investment for anthropologists, not that that's strange, but in that way we really think and sense that there will be commitment not only with the children in the research, but also with all the different institutions that have to do with educational policy. The ethical question is a very important one. Do we really want to continue this way of doing research still? Because I do support what has been said in the technical details about the new program. So having partnership, having collaboration, working with researchers. But still, I think that if we talk about valorization, we should valorize first. So not again thinking about what would be interested regarding to these, you know, topics of sustainability and so forth and so on, but first having our discussions with our partners and then in collaboration doing the research. I think the suggestion, and then I will finish, about filming is a very good one, but also in terms of ethics and methodology, because we are filming and it will be on the website. But you need, of course, the consent of all the people who are included in the research and the films you are making, that they also accept what will happen with the material if you put it online. But I'm sure that is one of the very good manners to deal with accessibility of the data and so forth and so on. And I hope we will show it in the future on our website, but still, there are lots of ethical questions to be asked. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yvonne. Time for one quick question. Time for one quick question. Yes, over here.
I'm Marie de Bracht from the Dutch National Institute of Health, the RIVM. And I like your talk very much, but sometimes we run into problems, for example, with Zika. If you ask the Caribbeans if Zika is a problem, it's not a problem. It's all the expatriates, I think it's a problem. So we are faced now whether we should consider it a problem. So I like the idea to elaborate a little bit further, because it is very logic that you stated, and still there's some conflict in what should be thought is important, Zika being an example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do feel what you're aiming at. And yes, of course, there are differences in how things are perceived and how things are prioritized and what will be valued and what will be not valued. But again, maybe the first step in not doing research, but doing, for example, ethnography, is to question the problem with each other. And that was one of, you know, our reasons to propose actually research with, not on or about, but with children, not with adults. But going into this kind of play, not the conversation, but the play to understand each other at a very, very, very fundamental level of what is going on in life worlds, not your life world, because I do understand the urgency of these kinds of problems, and that you or whoever wants to solve some problems, but you should have this common denominator and the same perception about it to work on it. And actually, not to propose research, I think, is the first step, but to have first your partnership.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Marjolein Christianen, and she'll be telling about sea turtles.
I am Marjolein Christianen. I'm involved in the project as a co-PI, and I'm working as a postdoc at Groningen University, and I've started 9 months ago on this project, and today I will present a setup and a fieldwork experiences and some first preliminary results. And I really want to start by thanking all of everyone stated here for their efforts, because it's really a effort of many people. All right, so at the 10th of October 2010, the Bass Islands became a special municipalities of the Netherlands, and automatically we have adopted responsibility to protect the species that come with it, under which there are 5 of the 7 species of sea turtles, and two of them, green and hawksbill turtles, they are on all 6 islands nesting. And research on these migratory marine vertebrates had really lagged behind many similar terrestrial animal groups. But studies on satellite systems and molecular technique can offer really great insights to guide marine conservation action plans. So sea turtles have different life stages. They come out of their egg, they passively drift through the ocean, then when they are approximately around the age of 3 or 4, they settle at shallow foraging areas, and then when they are mature, between the age of 20 to 30, they will migrate to their breeding areas and then to their nesting areas. And until now, most of the research have focused on adults. They are most easy to reach because adult females come up to shore and you can easily sample them or count their eggs or whatever. And this, the research on those subadult life stage is really just developing. And we really need this more input on their migration and population connectivity and habitat use to really provide input, solid input for management plans. and policies. So the key questions in our projects are how are turtles utilizing their present foraging and breeding habitats? Which are the critical habitats and what are the threats? What are the levels of past and present population connectivity? And what are the levels of past and present population size? And those questions are split up between two sub-projects, one sub-project. So I'm working on the first two questions. And Jurjan van der Zee, who's sitting there and has a really nice poster, is working on the second or the last two. So we focused on two turtle species, the green and the hawksbill turtle. And last year we did fieldwork on Bonaire, Aruba, and Curaçao. And next year we are going to St. Eustatius, St. Maarten, and Aruba and Ceiba. So last year we started our project with a meeting in which we involved all local collaborators, and this ensured their participation and involvement. And they are essential to this project, as our collaborators work already for many years on turtles on all the islands, and they have established the baseline data and set up the logistics. I'm really grateful to be able to work with them. And so how are we going to answer these four questions? First, we had to catch the turtles and tag the turtles using classical methods and using tags like flipper tags, satellite tags, so that we can map the movement of turtles between habitats. And we also collect a small piece of tissue of all turtles to determine the stable isotope signatures and and to do genomics on it. And these isotopes, they can also tell you a bit on where the turtles have eaten and on what they have eaten for the last couple of months. So it's also a tracker, more or less. So we went into the field. This is Curaçao. We went to the field with our local counterparts to catch the turtles. And the in-water work was not done on five of the six islands before. So this work also involved a lot of training of volunteers in these beautiful surroundings. So here you see a lot of volunteers in the water after a net was deployed here to cut off turtles fleeing away towards the sea. And this is a photo of the first tracker we placed on our first turtle, and this is one of eight we deployed this year. So after 2 hours of waiting, the epoxy has dried and the turtle is released into the water with now on its back a $6,000 tracker. So it's like throwing a bag of money into the sea, and then the big waiting begins. So the results here are still incoming. Some trackers are still tracking and providing us data. But here you already see some preliminary results of nesting females. So this is the typical turtles that are tracked. So this, So turtles were tracked in Bonaire and Curaçao, and you already see this one. A female, she traveled 3,100 kilometers in 3 weeks. She's really fast. Even if I have to do that cycling, I would be really, tired. So they are going all directions, and it's hard to see patterns in if you have only some replicates, but we are very lucky because Sea Turtle Conservation Bonaire is already working since 2003 on those turtles, and they have collected data on 24 more individuals of three species. And if you combine them all, you see some patterns occurring. And two areas seem to be of real importance or of particular importance for a lot of us individuals, namely this benthic foraging areas close to Nicaragua and Honduras, and this one in Venezuela. And you also see that there seem to appear to be some corridors along which the animals are moving. And this is really important for nature management, because turtles are breeding in Bonaire face threats from legal take, harvesting, and other threats in different EEZ. So they are crossing multiple different economic zones. So this really underscores the need for a broad international cooperation in efforts aimed at protecting these endangered species. So that were those were the adult samples. But what is new in this IS project is that we also track the subadult individuals. And until now, researchers thought, okay, subadults stay somewhere. They forage in a bay. For green turtles, they forage on seagrasses. But we don't really know what they were doing until they reached 30 years of maturity. And here you see data points of four individuals. So every color is another individual. And we really have to look into this a lot further. But what you can see is during the day, they graze inside Lock Bay. This is a seagrass bay on Bonaire, which is one of the, it's a really big bay full of seagrass. And this is one of the most important foraging areas for sea turtles in that area. So at daytime, they are munching on the grasses here, and then at night, they are going to the coral reefs to rest in the deeper areas. And, well, they continue to do this for a couple of months, and then three of those have already left, and they are now somewhere else, in Colombia, in Venezuela, and one track ended in Guyana. So they are doing different things that people expected them that they would be doing. And we are now analyzing their daily movement and activity patterns. So we learned that Lock Bay in Bonaire is a really important habitat for green turtles. But something based on the surveys of permanent transects of one of our collaborators there, Stinapa, has learned us that there is a new species of seagrass, an invasive seagrass species, Halophila stipulacea, evading the bay, and it's replacing the native species, Thalassia testudinum. Thalassia testudinum is the species on which green turtles are really dependent for their food. So we asked them, so what does this mean for the food availability for green turtles? Yes, that's working. So we performed some cafeteria experiments on these sticks. There are three different seagrass species, and turtles can choose what they are going to eat, and then they are eating the thalassia. And if you repeat all those experiments multiple times, then we do see that turtles eat the invasive seagrass species. So we have records on that. But it seems to be that the turtles really prefer thalassia much more, and they that's a nice thing that we found, or I don't know how nice it is. But then if you look at the satellite pictures from, and you zoom in this area, here you have Lock Bay again, and this whole area is covered by seagrass, and this dark area is long seagrass, and these lighter areas here are completely cropped areas where turtles has munched down the seagrass really short. And this border is so sharp because it's getting too shallow there for the turtles to graze. If it's too shallow, they are really unhandy foraging, so they're kind of starting to float. So they want to avoid that area. And from 2003 to 2010, we have satellite pictures. And until 2010, this border is always at the same place. But then in 2010, when the first reports are from this invasive seagrass species getting into the bay, we see this border shifting. So first the border is here, and then the border is going that direction. So here you also see the points of where we had the turtles grazing on seagrass. So there's something is happening that we don't know exactly what it is yet, but it could be that the turtle population is increasing, and they have to expand their foraging area to find enough food. Or it could be that this invasive seagrass species is replacing their native seagrass species, what the species that turtles prefer, and that turtles have to go in search for other seagrass. So we further mapped also the nesting and foraging location of turtles in all six islands, which are currently being prepared in a report for the ministry, and which really provides a nice overview of the important areas for turtles. And so now over to sub-project two, project where Jurjan is working on. Jurjan is currently running the analysis on the population structure and the demographic history of green and hawksbill turtles. And I only introduce the questions that he's working on, and then I hope you will also visit his poster in the back of the room. So here we study the past and present population connectivity by studying the composition of foraging populations, and by sampling DNA from foraging population, we can measure the gene flow among breeding and foraging areas. And then we also, Jurjan is going to look at how turtle breeding populations are genetically isolated and how much gene flow is there. And then there is also the third part of the project is, in which we use ancient or samples from the collections of Naturalis that are turtles sampled already a long time ago, and by studying that DNA and comparing that with current DNA, we can also compare the past and present population sizes and see what the effect was of the harvest and so on. Okay, so please have a look at Jurjan's poster and ask him for more details. And for the first time, we can now integrate results from tracking, genomics, and isotope analysis, and which are all different aspects or different perspectives on dispersal and migration of habitat use and health. And all data will be incorporated in the Dutch Caribbean biodiversity database and will be available to the public and policymakers. And we also asked how it was to do research in the Caribbean. I have made a really small table on some pros and cons of our fieldwork there. Some challenges was that it was quite expensive. I think my budget ran out three times faster than during my previous projects working in Indonesia, for example. And we were really happy that there is so much knowledge already available and that there are so many people already involved in nature conservation and that there are so many NGOs working there. We're really lucky to be cooperating with them. But now we want to combine all the data from the islands, and we really have to also work on standardization of these knowledge. And well, the extra research task can sometimes also put a little bit more pressure on monitoring efforts that have to that are continuing. And while there is islands internet on all the islands, it's still sometimes a challenge to get and stay in touch by email because the distance is still far. But even despite these minor challenges, we are very happy that the NWA gave us funding and provided us to do this great research. So thank you for your attention, and thanks for our sponsors. And
thank you very much, Marjolein. We're running a little bit late, so I will pass on the questions. The beer is waiting for us. But before we end, I would like to ask Niels to come up, and you give him a round of applause for his effort. Thank you. And for Joseph Soufer, who actually did all the work. Thank you very much.